Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Future Friday. In today's episode, we're gonna continue our saga of Moon and we're gonna figure out how do we light Moon and Mars habitats. So let's dive right into it. Now first thing, very obvious thing, let there be light. We need light to operate, as simple as that. Our biggest input system is optical based, basically our eyes, that has the biggest bandwidth to our brain. So we need light for everything, for operation and survival. So there is no doubt that we actually need a lot of it. Then the biggest problem with that is what light is made of, what we call photon. Now photons have different frequencies. Now as you can see, this is a easy visualization, but we can only see a very little part of it, part of it. That's why I'm saying we can't actually see it, like this whole spectrum we can't see it. Now of course not all of this is harmful to us, because many of you know FM radio is not gonna cause you any damage, however microwave can, and let's say x-ray is not that dangerous, but gamma ray is flat out lethal. So as you can see, like, we need light, but we can't see light. We can only perceive a visible light spectrum, which is a very tiny fraction. So this is a very crucial aspect. And on top of that, given the fact that you are now in space where you are getting full love from sun and extra love from space, we have what we call space radiation, which is generally comprised of multiple things. And you must be seeing word cosmic radiation thrown around. Basically, think of it in terms of space radiation. So we look at the idea of windows. Like, this is the most common science fiction trope, and many of you know International Space Station have some windows. So the idea is very simple and efficient. There is no tiglum to it, there is no complexity about it. However, it allows everything in. So this sort of diagram is going around on the internet, where you can see you have whole habitat covered in, you know, regolith, basically moon soil, and that's for providing your meteor protection, radiation protection. Now okay, everything is awesome about that. However, if you pay attention to the part that it's window, it's directly in, like there is no stopping it. Now you cannot build a glass that stops radiation. This is flat out not possible with our current technology. Maybe in future we can make crystal structures that is, like, you know, very robust and only allows specific wavelength to pass, but right now we cannot do that. So whenever you see UV coating, this and that, you know, x-ray coating and all that, those reduce it, but they cannot eliminate it, because if they actually started blocking out everything, they will simply heat up, and that heat can cause serious damage on a crystal level. So this allows everything, and let's say this much regolith, let's say 1 meter thick regolith, is strong enough as a barrier that it can protect against neutron emissions. This will not, because you have a direct cavity that can, you know, allow neutron direct path. So windows are very dangerous in this sort of scenario. Like, it's, if you want to stay on Moon, if you want to stay on Mars, as in long term, I'm not talking month, I'm talking years, decades, as in like there is 24x7 into 36x5, like there is always some people there. Window is not suited. The sole reason ISS can even support it is simply because it's below Earth's magneto shield, and heck, there is a significant amount of atmosphere on top also. Most of atmosphere is like 99% is below, but enough is on top that it requires a reboosting every few years, and it is protected. It is very thoroughly protected. And even then, you can see International Space Station has only few windows. It's not like it's covered with windows. Windows are not a very good solution. So if you are making a concept art or future or things alike, please pay attention to that. You can't just have giant windows. Looks cool, but it's very dangerous. So windows are a good starting point, but they will not get us far. However, mirrors, on the other hand, they are a completely different story. Now mirror has one side effect. Let's say you started using mirror, you will have no view. Basically, people might feel claustrophobic. They will have everything, but they will feel claustrophobic kind of scenario, because view will be compromised. However, it is very cheap and safe. Now what I mean by cheap, I'm not talking you need mirror like Hubble telescope mirror. You can have simply polished aluminum or polished steel. That's more than enough. Now the benefit of this mirror architecture is mirror flat out only reflects a very tiny spectrum. No matter how badly you want whole of the spectrum, a mirror can only reflect a portion of electromagnetic radiation. So let's say you have a mirror. Let's say this is your sunlight, it's coming down. vertically. Now you have a very thick radiation shield here, and on site you have a window. So there is no direct line of sight from sunlight to your window, okay? But you put a mirror here. Now here's the benefit: because you have radiation shielding on top of your habitat, you're not getting exposed by radiation. But won't you get a radiation if you like, you know, bounce it back? No. This is very crucial, because if you try to bounce anything, basically photons, you can only bounce back certain frequencies. Basically, normal mirror that we use, it can only work in basically visual spectrum. Little bit of infrared, little bit of ultraviolet, but not more. And if you have 2-3 mirrors bouncing back and forth, at the end you will have only, you would have filtered out everything. This is critical aspect of it. So even if, let's say in my analogy, if you have sun here, light is coming down, it's like, let's say it's full gamma radiation, it's coming down, boom. The gamma radiation will flat out go through the mirror, but mirror will only reflect photons that are of low energy, and it will go over here. Now again, you can have another mirror here that will, you know, filter out whatever survive. Let's say a little bit of infrared survive, little bit of UV radiation survive, you will filter it down. So as many mirrors as you have, the more filtered light you get at the other end. So this is why mirrors are the better approach for long-term stay. Like if you just want to go there and like, you know, stay in there like 5-6 days, you don't have to worry about too much. But in terms of long-term survival, we need mirrors. So how are we gonna employ those mirrors? It's basically, we're gonna have a very small window where all the light is focused in. Basically, we're gonna have something like this. Now, benefit of this, these individually are very cheap. And even in moon, you can build instead of building these small, you can build very large ones, because moon does not have a strong gravity, nor strong atmosphere, nor rain. So you can make them very simply, and you don't have to worry about oxidation. So even if you, let's say, mining iron, and you, let's say, polished iron, you don't have to worry about it being, you know, corroded. It will last for a very long time, unless it's get directly bombarded by meteorite. Over time it will happen, but it will not happen like, you know, today or tomorrow. So you are safe. So you can flood the whole area with this thing, bounce all the light, of course, wherever it must be underground for best survivability against neutron radiation and cosmic radiation. You have to be underground, as deep as you can go. So in case of moon, we are lucky that moon has something we call lava tubes. So you will have on the rim of the basically cave in where you're going down, you'll have a lot of heliostat that will bounce the light to one mirror, and mirror will bounce it back. So every time that bounce back is happening, first this mirror itself will filter out everything. And let's say you are getting cold, like let's say you are not feeling warm enough, you can coat these mirrors with gold, because gold reflects infrared very effectively. You can have some heliostats that reflect gold. And let's say you find out, hey, you need a little bit of ultraviolet for vitamin D synthesis, and plant life also utilizes very little, you don't need too much. There are certain elements that reflects ultraviolet very effectively. So you can coat the mirror. You get the ability to control what you are getting in. And while all the light is bounced back, let's say from rim, you bounce it to the central point where you have simple mirror, nothing fancy, it's just a simple mirror. You bounce it back, and then you bounce it back. To get into your habitat, you have to send it through a window. Now in that window, you will have something very simple, what we call air filled glass. Basically that glass, you will fill it whatever element you need. Like if you are worried about sound, you won't be in space, but let's say you are worried about rocket launches and all that, it will sound a little bit. You can fill it with helium, you can fill it with argon, you can fill it, depending on what you need, you can fill it with water also, that acts as a very good heavy neutron. Let's say for some reason, some random neutrons, finds a straight path, water will block it out. So that way you get the best of both worlds. You get as much light as you want, very specifically filtered out. So let's say you are like, a lot of people started to come there, and human body emits in heat. So you are like, okay, let's remove the heliostats that are reflecting infrared. Boom, your temperature comes down. Now people leave, and like only 2-3 people are there, but now the temperature system is dropping. You have infrared heliostats reflecting back in. So we can control very precisely and exactly what we want. So sun is giving you a lot of power, a lot of radiation also, but thankfully our star is not very bright in x-ray or gamma rays. It's ludicrously bright in infrared, so we can control it very optimistically and very easily also. Heliostats are quite a simple technology. So you will only difference would be like these are tower, you won't have towers. Like these will be on the surface, and the heliostat will reflect it on top, like they won't try to reflect directly down. It's very engineering wise very complex, but from this mirror you will go under down, and that way you can get completely filtered safe lighting. So you will have small window and large field of heliostats. So question comes up, why go through this route? Now first thing is plant mutation. Now many of you are aware of the fact that we used to use actual radiation as a genetic mutation. Now in the early days, we did not have the technology that we can go into genome of plant and tamper it. So what we used to do is directly expose it to nuclear radiation and mutate it. Now 99% of the mutations were pointless and deadly, but some mutations out of millions that were tried, some mutation ended up giving, let's say, more corn, some ended up giving sweet corn. So of course this was tested. It was not like, okay, it's giving sweet corn but turns out it has a carcinogenic into it. We handled it. Like that was our old method of genome editing or GMOs. However, now we have technology to directly go and do much more precise editing without needing radiation. Now, space has a lot of radiation, so every plant you plant in your habitat, if you're lighting it from external sources to reduce your energy consumption, you are still exposed to the same problem. You can't have greenhouse on Mars because we don't have any technology that allows us to directly filter out whatever we want, unless we use mirrors. For this reason, to make sure your plant doesn't mutate like this, and these are low level mutation, there are much more subtle mutations that could subtly affect the crop in a way that you can't detect it visually without having a very giant lab and processing every single corn, that let's say increase the concentration of this or that, and that causes cancers in human body. So you don't want to risk it, because if you have plant life acting as a food source or acting as a air scrubber, you want to make sure they survive, they don't get exposed to radiation that they are not built to handle. For this reason we have to do this. Second, if you let's say live on Mars and you have large habitat, or in moon and you are growing plant, now plants grow optimally if you have red light, not green, not blue, red light. They use the most amount of red light simply because if you light it up with green light, as many of you know, green will reflect green away, so it's not gonna use it. Now benefit of that is, like, if you are bouncing lot of light in, you can flat out block every other wavelength, and you can be like only red light goes in. The benefit of that is, like, you can send in so much light that that area wherever you are growing the habitat can grow a lot more crop. Now can you do with white light? No, because if you put too much white light there, the temperature will go up and plants will burn off. That's why there is a lot of research in hydroponics. Now if you have vertical farms, as you have like lot of, they try to do with bright white lights, but problem is those light itself was creating lot of energy consumption, and they were giving off heat. Like the photons do carry a visible spectrum, does carry heat, so it was heating and burning the plants. To make sure that you have lot of plant in very small area, you have to make sure the temperature is low. Now instead of wasting energy by running a refrigeration, they simply figured out, why not simply give the energy that plant is using? Red light. So this allows us to use mirrors much more effectively. You can simply send too much light in one place and filter whatever you don't need. That way you can run this sort of hydroponics plant at much higher density. So like let's say you have one small habitat which has let's say 100 cubic meter of space, you can pack that up to brim and have a lot of plants living there. If you try this with white light, it's not like it's not gonna, but white light itself will start heating up the scenario, so you will need cooling for that, so why bother? And human skin is not very kind of indestructible. Unless you are man of steel, we are kind of vulnerable, especially to UV radiation. Even though our cells have some level of photosynthesis where we utilize the UV radiation that we gain to break down complex molecules and get small things like out of it, primary being vitamin D, we can't handle heavy UV radiation. And not to mention, simply because our earth is protected by ozone layer, we have no concept of what kind of damage UV radiation, that is space UV radiation, does. Now you might be aware of, there used to be a hole, used to be because it's now filled, but even that minor exposure, like it wasn't like that ozone used to be there, now it's gone. It, that hole was like depleted ozone. There were like amount of ozone went down, but it not went to zero. So that causes a very serious skin damage. And I'm talking about skin damage for long, short-term exposure. But if long-term exposure happens, let's say by your window you're getting exposed to is 24/7 or however long you have, you will develop skin cancer. So this is why we have to do this mirror approach, because as of now, as I talk to you, we don't have the technology to build a transparent material that can only allow a specific wavelength. Everything will go through a window. So for this reason, mirrors are our best solution. So you want to protect human and make sure you have a lot of vegetation and don't end up mutating the plants, we have to wear this thing. This was my presentation on how do you light things in space, basically in moon or Mars. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, I would urge you to subscribe, share it amongst your friends, leave a comment what you want to see in the next episode of Future Friday. And if you didn't like it, don't worry about it. You can dislike it. And I would urge you to press the bell icon if you're free. And as always, thanks for watching.